There are many ways to represent graphs in 3D. One of the good ways is to use vector-valued functions. Vector-valued functions. And what this essentially means is we'll have RT is going to be equal to FT in the I direction plus some other function, GT in the J direction. And plus h of t, some other function, in the k direction. And this should just basically split apart a function into three components, and there's going to be like an arrow drawing out the curve. So instead of the curve being there, there's going to be almost an invisible arrow pointing and drawing out that curve. That's going to kind of make your vector-valued function. They're not too difficult to work with because you can distribute things like limits, derivatives, and integrals. And of course, I'm sure we probably remember the product rule. So if we were going to take like the derivative d over dt, we have one function, f of t, and then g of t. We can just take the product rule of this and rewrite them both times, ft, gt plus ft, gt, and then take the derivative of one and then the derivative of the other on the other side. Well, this is called the scalar product rule. Scalar product rule. But what if we were to do the dot product rule? Because you can't just multiply vectors together. You have to do either dot products or cross products. So we'll take the derivative of, and we're going to call this vector rt, and we're going to dot that with another vector ut. And it's going to be exactly the same thing, but with dots. So we're going to rt dot ut, and then plus rt dot ut, and we're going to apply the derivative on one and the other. It's pretty easy. Now we can try looking at the cross product. So the cross product rule. And it's going to be exactly the same thing. We'll start by crossing R cross U. And we will find that it's going to be RT cross UT plus RT cross UT. And you take the derivative of both sides. And should be good. That's going to be easy ways to work with vectors, taking derivatives. Dot products, cross products, everything. The next concept is curvature. Now I started this diagram here, and I'm basically tracing out this line right here called RT. That's going to be our vector-valued function. And I have this little circle here that's just basically trying to describe how this curve is very small compared to this curve, which is much larger. We're going to have a little radius right here. This radius is going to be much smaller than this radius. So therefore, if we take the equation r equals 1 over k, k being the curvature, k being 1 over r, just so where there's no confusion. In this case, let's say the radius was just like, I don't know, 0.5. That's just like a half, right? Then the curvature would just be 2. Curvature is 2. It's kind of a small little radius of 0.5, right? And then over here, we could say, well, this one's a much bigger radius. Let's call that a radius of 3. So then we'll end up with the curvature of 1/3 on this one. Curvature is 1/3. So you can see that if we have a small curvature, then we're going to have kind of a big, smoother curve. Small curvature, smoother curve. If we have a really higher curvature, then it's going to be a really quick curve. And that's kind of what curvature is all about. Well, let's just say we wanted to start drawing some tangent lines everywhere. We could draw tangent lines here and there and there and here and everywhere. We'd have some tangent lines. But all of a sudden, right here, we could draw a tangent line. And it also turns out that that tangent line at that point is also going to be, well, isn't the tangent just the derivative of RT? So we could say that this right here is going to be the tangent line, which is RT, like that derivative of the R. And this is going to be the velocity, right? It's velocity. But at the same time, it's also the tangent. All right, and I'm going to draw this little chunk of thing right here because we're going to try to normalize this tangent section. So that way we just have a unit in whatever direction that tangent line is, we're going to get a unit vector. That's a unit vector of 1. All right, so what I can say over here is that if I get the tangent vector like this, and I'm going to put the little hat like this to indicate it's kind of like a unit vector. It's just like the I, the J, or the K. I'm just going to make a directional tangent vector. And I'm going to set that equal to the velocity, right? And I'm just going to normalize the velocity. So VT, and then we're going to divide that by the magnitude. Magnitude. Don't need to double there. I need to double here. Okay. So yeah, we got the magnitude right there. And that's going to give us the tangent unit vector. Interesting. Okay, and so we found this tangent vector. Now let's say we wanted to find a vector that was normal to the tangent vector in this direction. In order to do that, we would have to take the derivative of the tangent vector, and then we would get the perpendicular component, right? Something kind of like this. So we could say that the normal component, and I'm going to normalize it by making a unit vector. We're going to say that that's equal to the derivative of the tangent vector, like this. The derivative of the tangent unit vector over, and we're going to normalize it. So we just, again, we take the derivative of the tangent unit vector. Now that's interesting. Derivative of a tangent unit vector. The derivative of a unit vector. I mean, that's just weird because, again, if you take the derivative of I, usually these unit vectors, they don't really change, right? But here's the thing. So notice that this normal is pointing towards this center, right? Well, let's say you were going around the center, it would have some sort of an angular change. So because you're changing the direction that it's pointing, the vector is also changing. And so that's really what this is trying to measure. It's trying to measure the angle that it's changing at, the rate at which the angle is changing based off of the speed and, you know, the distance that it's moving and stuff like that. So that's really what this is trying to say. Now let's just write down some equations for curvature, some other ways to represent this. We might have to calculate it. So again, it's going to be the derivative of the tangent unit vector, but that's the magnitude of that divided by the change of is the speed. Okay, so got the magnitude is speed here and the derivative of the tangent vector, and so that's going to give us the k, the actual curvature. There's another equation is going to be magnitude of cross product between velocity and the acceleration divided by magnitude of the velocity to the third power, or we could also say the absolute value of second y prime 2 1 plus y prime squared to the 3 over 2 on the bottom there. So yeah, just a couple of different ways we can represent k, and now we can kind of see how we can break this apart, figure out what we need. Another useful equation is going to be the arc length formula. So it's going to be s is the integral from t initial to t final, and the magnitude of the velocity over time. And that's going to give you the distance, right? Arc length. Now let's examine the components of acceleration. Let's say we had an acceleration vector that was like, I don't know, pointing in this direction, kind of like over here. And that's going to be a of t. The acceleration could just be pointing anywhere. In that case, then in the tangent direction over here, we're going to get a component of a. I'm going to call that at. And in the direction of the normal vector, we're also going to get a component of a. So that's an. And so we have here, there's going to be the n unit vector down there, and also the t unit vector. It would actually be pointing only in this direction, so this wouldn't even really be there. But you can kind of see that it's mainly just, you know, this direction here with the t exactly at that point, and then this direction here with the n going up this way. Up to that point there. And these are just one in each direction. Then we got the continuation would give you the direction of the acceleration and the continuation. So it's kind of a sloppy little mess there, but you can kind of see, yeah, that's just breaking everything apart. And we can represent this by saying at is going to be equal to, and we'll say that this is v prime, and then here is the tangent vector there, plus, this is going to be just regular velocity squared, and then times k, and this is times the normal vector over here in t. Let's bring this down to the next line, and we're going to say at is equal to the component of that tangent in that direction, and we're just rescaling the tangent unit vector over there. As you can see, it makes a lot of sense. Rescaling the unit vector plus the component of the normal times the normal unit vector. So that makes quite a bit of sense there. And then we're also going to say, okay, if we wanted to figure out what at was, we have a formula for that. We could say r double prime dotted with the t unit vector, which will give us r prime dotted with r double prime divided by the magnitude of acceleration. And this is a scalar because, again, we're rescaling the unit vector. And we could also go to the an and say r, that's acceleration, times, and that's cross the normal vector, equals r cross with r double prime. This is going to be the magnitude here divided by r double prime on the bottom. And here's another scalar here. This is just keeping everything scalar. Now, the suggested root to be able to calculate all this stuff is generally going to be RT first, RT, and then we would use VT, and then we get the magnitude of V, and then we could figure out AT, those kinds of things. Once we kind of know those, then it should be very easy to calculate any one of these, which would be the tangent unit vector, or the normal, or, you know, the components of velocity. It doesn't matter really what order you figure this out in too much. Well, a little bit, but it's not too big of a deal. So this is how we can break apart the acceleration. Everything should be pretty simple so far. Now let's try graphing some of these vector functions. I made a graph of sine t, negative t, and cosine t. And we're just going to be basically looking at what happens in the x direction. As you can see here, it's going to be moving quite a bit in the x direction, all the way from here to that side. So it's like, it's like big, it's a big travel distance here. So I'm going to call this the thick axis. The x is a thick axis. On this one over here, look, we've only spanned like one tube. Like that's literally a distance of two. So that's like a really small distance here. So the y is going to be like a thin axis because we haven't really gone very far there. These circles, you kind of want to imagine them a little bit bigger than they seem. But you can see We've only traveled like that far in the Y dimension. We've traveled that much in the X dimensions and this much in the Z dimensions. So like this is gonna be also a very big, thick dimension, the Z right there. And that's just for this graph. Now we also wanna consider that if we have spirals, like for example, really tight spirals, you would say this is gonna be like 4T, many T's packed together. But if you have only a very thin spiral, you know, maybe just three or something like that, it would be more like, you know, a third T. So like just a very loose amount of spirals, not very many. Yeah. Now let's look at the behavior of these graphs. So I have another example here, T, T squared, and negative three. But let's return to this one for a second, because imagine we didn't have this negative t here, and we just had a sine t and a cosine t. You can now imagine just a circle, essentially, right? But it would be a flat circle. But because we have this negative t, then we know that something is happening in this y direction. It's going from the positive to the negative. So it's literally just untwisting this circle, okay? And it's creating this thing. And because we know that it's going in this direction from the positive to the negative y, then we also know what direction the z's are going and the x's are going, because it has to spiral in this direction to go that way. So now we've discovered, you know, how this graph looks, and let's look at the other one, because we would have a t. Let's try to describe this with English words. So if it goes from t, then we know that it would go from negative to positive, negative to positive, in the x direction. Let's see if that's true. So we go over here and it's going from, well, the negative side to the positive side. So we can see that it's traveling in this direction in the x component. And that's fine, which basically means, okay, let's go to this thing. It's supposed to be parabolic in the y direction here. So it's parabola. Parabola. It makes sense. It means it starts here, goes like that. You can just kind of see it's going both in both directions. That's really the key. It's not just going in one direction like that one. And if it was to the third, you would see three directions. One, two, three. You can think of how many zigzags does it have. How many zigzags? This exponent is the zigzags. Zigzags. That's the exponent. It zigzags once, basically. All right, if it was the third, it'd be one, two, three. And then here on the third one, we can see that it's stuck because there is nothing happening in the Z. It's stuck in the Z axis. And I believe that makes sense. There isn't supposed to be any up or down here. This is just supposed to be straight across from here to there. But yeah, so anyway, that's kind of the idea. So it starts and ends in the same point on the z-axis, and there's nothing happening on the z, it's just that negative 3. So you can kind of see that happening. And I didn't even draw anything in the z-component because, well, there wasn't really supposed to be anything happening there. Again, we can consider this to be the thick side, because you could see it's wide, a lot of stuff happening, and this is also a thick side over here. So we can see that manifesting itself right there. And the thin side is the Z. There's nothing happening in the Z side, so we can call it thin. Let's try another example. Got negative x squared minus z squared plus y minus 5 equals 0. And because y has no power, we are going to set this whole thing in terms of y. There's no power here. That's great. We're going to use that to our advantage. We're going to rewrite this as y equals x squared plus z squared plus 5. And then we can set x equal to 0, z equal to 0, and we're going to find y equals 5 when that's the case. And so now we can start to try to graph this. And what's kind of important is to realize that, okay, so y equals 5 when everything is 0, so that means there's like a 5 right here on the y. And this being x squared, y squared, z squared. I'm gonna make this little symbol right here. It's gonna look like this. Because that is what the graph is gonna look like if we have like parabolas, right? So it should look like that in all directions. Like if we go to this y-axis and we say, let's try to make the y equals x squared graph. That would be something like y equals x squared would literally just look like this. Y equals x squared, right? Okay. And then if we wanted to do y equals z squared, then we would just tilt the axis and we would do the same thing right here. Y equals z squared, and we kind of get this little thing like that. And I want to make sure we have a little round tip. Doesn't really look like much, but essentially this is supposed to be a parabolic cone type of thing. Some of these look a little bit better than others. Yeah, it's supposed to be like a cone. Parabola in that direction. Get the x side doing this and the z side doing that, and then there's your y axis. It starts at 0.5 here. This is going to be y equals 5 right there at that point. Then we have a parabola, so let's just look at that. In this next example, we can see that this is the only positive value, the x squared. And because it's the only positive, it's positive. Let's use that to our advantage. And let's rewrite this equation as x equals, you know, 1. Well, here, the square root z squared plus y squared plus 1. Okay. And then we'll set z equals 0, y equals 0. And we see that square root of 1. But it's plus or minus the square root. So it's x equals plus or minus the square root there. And because it's plus or minus, then it's going to be two parabolas. So we actually get something that looks more like that. And that's the symbol that is going to represent what we want the graph to look like. And because it's at 1, then we're just going to try to represent that here on this graph. Kind of like, fine, x equals 1, that's going to be right here, and x equals negative 1 is right there, and then it's just going to be parabolic in both directions. So we'll go ahead and try to draw that out. In the z components, here we'll draw this little thing first. So it should kind of look like this. Here's a z component. And then this would be the y component, kind of more curling this direction and this direction. And so we get this crazy looking parabola in that way. And then it would also happen again in this direction, like here. And then we got our z components. And the y component here. Alright, so anyway, this is basically how it's going to be looking. And we could set x equal 1 here and x equal negative 1 on that side. And so it's just more a couple of examples of how these parabolas might look. Now for the equation y equals 5, x, y equals 5x, here's our 3D graph. And let's try to draw y equals 5x on this 3D graph. It would look something like here, super slanted, super fast, y equals 5x. And then what's z? Well, z could be anything. So we're gonna make a big plane in this thing. Literally just extend z however far we want. And there we go, we've got a nice little plane. And the z-axis, we'll build a box. And this is absolutely parallel to that line. So just keeping that in mind, these things are like just a flat plane like that. And let's also consider x squared equals 4. Because if we square root to both sides, we're going to get the plus and minus thing happening again, which means x should be equal to 2 on this side and negative 2 on this side. And then that means that we're going to get extending. What's the y? It could be extended in this direction as far as it wants to, and that direction. And what's z? It could be up and down any direction. So we kind of have this extension, and then we can just start making this into a box. That. So we're just extending this because doesn't really matter. This is going to be more parallel to the origin over there, but the boundaries are more really what matters here. Let's draw this because it looks like a plane like that. And then on the negative side, we also have the 2 going up, coming down, kind of like that, and extending as far as it needs to. There we go. So we have another plane thing happening over there. So anyway, that's going to be two planes side to side if you have the x squared, and there's just only one thing happening. There's just a couple of different more examples of how to graph these things. Now you might know the equation of a circle, because that would be x minus a squared plus y minus b squared equals r squared. But if we were to put this into 3D, then we could say that the z-axis kind of equals whatever distance that we want. And so we would have a shape that looks more like this. But let's just say that we wanted to look at it only from the top. Then we would actually get our circle again. Right? We can call this tracing image. We would get a square if we look at it from that side, right? Now there's other ways that we can represent cylinders, because these are pretty common shapes, cylinders. Let's see, we would have like 2x squared minus y equals z. And that would give us a shape that would look more like a parabola that's like extended like this. And we can kind of like call that a cylinder. It's like a half of a cylinder. So if we looked at it from the side, it would look like that. And we could also look at y equals sine x. That would seem more like a little spiral here, and it'll be in 3D in such a way. Wrap around here. Do stuff like that. And so if we would look at it from the top though, then it would become again just a straight sine wave. So you can kind of see how these things can go between 3D and 2D. As a side note, we should also consider cylindrical coordinates. If we want to represent these cylinders, we can say r, theta, and then a z. And that's just going to be x equals r cosine theta, y equals r sine theta, and z equals z. This could be a theta or a t, doesn't really matter. We could also say x squared plus y squared equals r squared, and tan theta is equal to y over x. If we have an x squared over a squared plus or minus the y squared over b squared plus or minus the z squared over c squared equals 1, then we can call that a hyperbola. Or even an ellipse, depending on what we're looking at. Because here would be an ellipse, like this, if it was all pluses. That's an ellipse. Or it could look like this. Some twisted shape there. If it was like 1 plus and 1 minus, that's what it would look like. And if it was both minuses, then you would actually have a gap. That would look kind of something more like this. This is both minuses. And if it was equal to 0, then you get a shape like this. instead of 1 if it was equal to 0. You get a shape like that. And for parabolas, let's say we have z equals x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared. This is a parabola. Then we would see things like just something like that. If it was a plus, then it would look like that. Now, if it was a minus, you get this really weird shape that I don't even really kind of get, but it's just this crazy thing like this that goes infinite off in these directions, and then it's like a parabola inside. I don't know, it's kind of a weird thing, so you kind of have to look at it on like a big 3D graph, I guess, to sort of picture this. Computer generated, then I'll really show you a better picture, but it's going to look something like that if you have only a negative there. This would be obvious, plus or minus right there. So plus is nice, and the negative is not so nice. It looks kind of like this really weird shape. It's like an anti-parabola.